بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين جل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وجعلنا من أعوانه وأنصاره اللهم أخرجني من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمني بنور الفهم اللهم افتح علينا أبواب رحمتك وانشر علينا خزائن علومك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessing of meeting you again and continuing our discussion about Islamic belief system. And inshallah, today we want to start the second part of Unit 2. So the first part was about arguments for the existence of God, and now we want to study attributes of God. This is very important. Because if you know that God exists, but you don't know who is God and what qualities he has, then you would not be able to relate to God in the way that you should. There have been people in the course of history that believed in God, but because they didn't have right vision, right understanding, so they started, for example, worshipping idols. They became polytheists. So there are problems among the people who manage to come one step forward and believe in God, but were not able to know the qualities of God properly. What makes this more significant is that for us to know God is not something free from some problems. It's not something very easy. It is true that we have innate knowledge of God. We have that fitri knowledge of God. But when it comes to articulate it, it's very difficult. Why? Because we are always used to thinking of the things which have limits. Now, all our life, we have been dealing with something that is occupying a space, something that is in a certain time. So whenever we think of God, maybe even if you are 40 years, 50 years, 60 years old, still you may think of God as someone who is in the sky. And you know, when you raise your hand for qunut, you may really think that, you know, your hand is referring or pointing at God. It's very difficult for us to remove all these aspects and dimensions of material beings from God. There is a hadith from Imam Baqir alayhi salam, in which he is saying, كُلَّمَا مَيَّزْتُمُوهُ بِأَوْهَامِكُمْ فِي أَدَقِّ مَعَانِيهِ فَهُوَ مَخْلُوقٌ مِثْلُكُمْ مَرْدُودٌ إِلَيْكُمْ Whatever you articulate with your minds and think of it as God, it's your own creation and it will be sent back to you. It comes back to you. You think it's God, but it's not God. It's your created image of God. And me and you can never create something better than ourselves. Please remember this point. Can we ever create something better than ourselves? Never. Because we cannot give perfection to something more than that what we have. Any person, whatever he or she does or creates, would be lower than him or her. Okay? It's impossible for us to create something greater than ourselves. Even when it comes to imagination, yes, I can imagine, maybe, you know, for example, a person who is better than me, but this is just imagination. And when it comes to our mind, we have this problem, which is built over years, that our mind is used to think of things as physical things, as material things, as three, you know, dimensional things, things that occupy time, space. It's very difficult. Even when we think of angels, we want to think of something physical. If we think of, you know, light, again, we think of physical light. We say, Allahu Nur as-Samawa. When we think of God, again, the same thing. So, Imam Baqir alayhi salam says, فَهُوَ مَخْلُوقٌ مِثْلُهُمْ. This is created by you. There is a saying from Amirul Mu'minin alayhi salam that if you ask an ant to describe God, you know, I'm just putting in my own words. If you ask an ant to describe God, so an ant would describe God as a giant ant, you know, because for them to be ant is very important. Then they just try to make it bigger, you know, like we think of God as a superhuman. Yeah, they think of God as super ant. If you ask a fish, you know, think God is a super fish. So this is the problem. We are very limited. There have been a serious discussion, very, very serious discussion in Christianity, in Judaism, in Islam, among theologians, not among, you know, illiterate people, among theologians. Can we at all describe God? There have been people who said, no, we cannot describe God at all. And we should just suspend any discussion about God. We should just stop talking about God. You can just repeat the scripture. But don't go beyond repeating. Don't try to explain, to analyze. You know, in Christianity you have this, in Judaism, in Islam. You have people who have had this idea that we should do what we call ta'til or tawakkuf, cancellation or suspension of any discussion about God's attributes. Because they said God is too great for us to be able to describe. You may have heard this saying, very famous saying of Ahmad ibn Hanbal, one of the people of Hadith, Ahlul Hadith. Ahlul Hadith is different from Muhaddith. Muhaddith means a scholar of Hadith. But Ahlul Hadith are a special group of Muslim thinkers who were very much interested in literal understanding of the things and not very much interested in logic, let alone philosophy. So when he was asked, what does Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa? Would you please explain? You know, what does it mean? Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa. I want to go beyond the just reading and repeating. I want to understand more. His answer is very, you know, striking. He said, "Al-istawa'u ma'lumun." Istawa literally is known. Istawa means to a stand to be subsistent, something like this. The question was, how can we say God is dominant over throne, Arsh? Okay, but he avoided answering. He said, Al-istiwa'u ma'lumun. The literal meaning is known. Wal-kayfu majhulun. The quality of it is unknown. Was-su'alu bid'atun. And asking about this is a heresy. Because in the time of Prophet, no one asked this question. So you should not ask this question. So very clear. You shouldn't dare asking question. Asking clarification. So, among Muslims, among Christians, among Jews, there were people who said we should not discuss qualities of God. There were people who tried to explain God, but somehow they suffered what we call anthropomorphism. Anthropomorphism means thinking of God as a human being. So they came up with some kind of tashbih. Have you heard mushabbiha? You know, the people who somehow likened God to human beings. And they, for example, took some of the sayings that you have in religious texts literally. About, for example, you know, even some people became mujassima. They went further and they considered the body for God, you know, hand and, you know, leg and this type of thing, you know, God wrestling. And so this is also one side of the extreme. But the Shia position and some other Muslim scholars has been that we have to find a way in between. Neither we totally cancel any discussion, nor we can easily attribute things to God. You have to be very careful about using concepts for God and then in analyzing those concepts. You have to be very careful. For example, can we use a concept which has not been used in the Quran and Hadith for God? This was a discussion, whether Asma'ullah are tawqifi or not. It means, if something has not been used in the Quran and Hadith, can I say this is a right description of God? For example, maybe in the Quran and Hadith, we don't have the concept of wajibul wujud, necessary being. It's a philosophical concept. Can we use it for God? Some people said no. Some people said yes. Normally, our scholars say we can use concepts for God which are not mentioned in the Quran and Hadith, but you have to be very careful. Whenever a concept is used for God, that concept must not be attached essentially. Please be, you know, listen carefully. It must not essentially be attached to limitations, to be corporeal, to be material. For example, we cannot use something like eating or drinking for God. Because in the very essence of eating and drinking, there is a problem. Or sleeping. But we can use, for example, concepts like knowing. Because in the essence of this concept, there is no problem. Yes, in human experience of knowledge, there is problem. Because our knowledge comes by learning. Our knowledge comes through concepts. Our knowledge is subject to confusion and illusion and forgetfulness and making mistakes. Leave all these things aside, but still something remains as the core of knowledge that can be used for God. Life is a subject that in human beings, in animals, in plants, come with problems, limitations. You have to breathe, you have to eat, you have to, you know, you need water. These limitations come with life for us. But the core of this concept is okay. You can use it for God. But when you use life for God, you have to be careful. Don't think of God's life like human life, not like animal life or vegetative life. Just think of all the positive things in life, all the perfection that comes with something which has life, but leave aside all the limitations that are in our life. Okay? But eating, you say, if you say, I want to do the same with eating, I say, no, the essence of eating has a problem. It's different from knowledge. It's different from life. Sleeping, the essence of it has a problem. So, our idea is we don't need to stop talking about God or thinking about God. And at the same time, we don't need to think of God as a human being or as a physical object. We have to find the balance. We have to be very careful. Whatever, in the best of our analysis, can be understood to be free from problems and be an indication of perfection, can be used for God, if you still say that God is greater than this. No matter, you know, how much you have tried to refine this concept of knowledge or life or will or power, still God is greater. Okay? You can never say, I understood everything about knowledge of God. I understood everything about life of God. No. We cannot understand everything about his knowledge or about his life or will or anything else. Allahu Akbar min an Yusuf. He is not greater only compared to other beings. He is greater even than our description. Yeah? Not only is he greater than all of us and any creature, he is greater even than our description. We cannot describe him. And this is why the Quran says, anyone who describes God has to describe God with glorification, with tasbih. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Whatever they describe still falls short, and God is greater than that, and therefore God has to be glorified. There is only one group of people that God is happy with their way of describing God, and those are mukhlasin. Subhanallah amma yasifun illa ibadallah al-mukhlasin. And mukhlasin is very, very high position, the highest position. It's not mukhlasin. Mukhlasin is very important, but mukhlasin is much more. Mukhlasin are those who purify their intention, their actions for God. But mukhlas is the one who is purified by God. After he or she has purified himself and intentions, then God takes this process further and purifies them. And something that I think, I'm not saying definitely this is the case, because I was thinking, even mukhlasin, they are still human beings, and they are still, you know, limited. So how God is not saying that with respect to them, there is a need for glorification, then one aspect might be this, that because these are the people that they avoid describing God by using concepts and terms. They try to describe God by their existence, by their light, by their piety, by their purity, by their spirituality. And therefore, when people look at them, they are not, you know, deviated or misguided or confused. They are just putting everyone into the direction that they can face God themselves. Anyway, that's another issue. So, we have to be careful not to use any concept which has problem essentially. And if there is no problem essentially, be careful about the accidental or, you know, external issues not to be attached, like life. Make it free from all the additional problems that come in human life or animal life, all the limitations, all the weaknesses. Okay, this was just to give you a little background about the significance of this discussion and how in all religious traditions, great scholars have been really involved in this and how ideas have been divided. But alhamdulillah, in our school, we have more uniformity among our scholars. So, how we can understand God and how we can describe God? Before we go into the arguments for the qualities of God, let us make some classifications so that, inshallah, then we can address each quality in its own type. A very typical classification is to divide divine attributes into attributes of glory or attributes of beauty. Attributes of beauty, sifatul jamal. You know, jamal means beauty. Jamil means beautiful. Sifatul jamal, attributes of beauty, are those attributes that we affirm, we confirm for God. Sifate thubutiyye. Thubut means they are correct, they are right, they can be attributed, ascribed to God. Like knowledge, like power, like will, like life. These are attributes of beauty or jamal. In contrast, we have another type, and this is attributes of glory, sifatul jalal. And these are those attributes that we negate. These are the things that are signs of imperfection, signs of limitation, and therefore we have to negate, we have to reject. For example, to be physical, we cannot accept God being a physical object. To occupy space, to occupy time, we cannot accept for God. To be visible, to be seen by physical eyes, we don't accept. Okay? To be, for example, father or mother or parent in general, or to be born, we don't accept. So these are sifatul jalal or sifat salbiyyah. Means these are negated. And of course, negation of imperfection would mean in the end a kind of perfection. Yeah, when you say God does not occupy space, the result is he's greater than space. Okay, this is very simple and straightforward. The other classification is that attributes of God are sometimes about his essence and sometimes about his actions. This is very important discussion, very useful, And alhamdulillah, in our kalam and philosophy, this distinction has very well been explained, and some people have not understood this in other traditions and has caused lots of problems. So I hope we can, inshallah, tonight clarify the distinction between these two types of attributes. Sifat, attributes which are related to essence of God. We call them as-sifat al-dhatiyya. Yeah? As-dhat means essence. As-sifat al-dhatiyya. In contrast to as-sifat al-fi'liyya, those attributes which relate to God's actions. What is the distinction? Of course, this classification comes next to the previous ones. So, you know, they can overlap. Like, for example, you say people in this room can be classified into men and women. They can be classified into, for example, who is sitting on the right or left. You know, you can classify the same thing in different ways. Therefore, these classifications can overlap. So, sifat al-zat or as-sifat al-zatiyya or qualities of essence are those qualities that describe essence of God. You don't need to have anything different from God so that you would be able to think of these qualities. You can just reflect and focus on the essence of God and analyze it and come up with these concepts. But sifatul fi'l can only be understood if we consider God and then something else, some of his creatures, and reflect on the relation between God and those creatures. Then we can reflect and abstract those qualities of action. Let me explain this first and then go to the quality of essence. Maybe this is easier. For example, you say God is Raziq, sustainer. When can you understand this concept? Imagine you are the person who wants to introduce this concept for the first time to other people, or he has read it somewhere or heard it from people and wants to make sense of it. What does it mean? How, for the first time, you can come with this concept, or if someone else talks about it, you can understand. There is no way to understand Raziqiyya for God unless you think of God and something else that is receiving sustenance from God. If you only focus on God, nothing else, no creature, Raziqiyya doesn't make sense. Yes? Yes, some of you may have this in your mind, that what about the power of God for Raziqiyya? Say, oh, that's different. Power of God for Raziqiyya, his ability to give rizq, this is his essence. This is different from Raziqiyya. Actual Raziqiyya, to give sustenance, needs someone to receive it. Raziq needs marzuq. Need, not in the sense of depending, in the sense that this concept cannot be understood unless it has two sides. Raziq, marzuq. Okay? So, is Raziqiyya a quality of essence or action? Action. Another quality of action, ghafir. God is forgiver and forgiving. Can we think of ghafir without someone to be forgiven? There must be a sinful person that is going to be forgiven or has been forgiven. And then we reflect and the nature of this relation, because God has many different types of relation with us. He is our creator, he's our sustainer, he's our guide, yeah, he's our purifier. He has many relations with us. One of the relations that can be between God and us is forgiving. But you can only understand forgiving when you consider something other than God, and you see this person has committed a sin, and God forgives him. So forgiving, ghafiriya or ghaffar. Ghafir and ghaffar means, ghafir means forgiving, and ghaffar is most forgiving. These are qualities of essence or action?
Action.
Khaliqiyya. To be creator. To be creator, not the power of creating. Power of creating is different from creating. Power of creating is quality of essence. That goes back to power. But actual act of creation. Can you have creator without something being created? No. So there must be khaliq and makhluq. And then we can abstract the notion of khaliqiyya. So these are qualities of action. Then qualities of essence. Qualities of essence are not in need of considering a creature of God and then reflecting on the relation between that creature and God. We can just focus on God. Imagine nothing is existing, or they may exist. We don't have any attention to them. We just focus on God. Whether other things exist or not, God has these qualities. For example, knowledge. Knowledge as a quality of essence, because there is a way of considering knowledge as a quality of action that if I get a chance, maybe I explain next week. But knowledge as a quality of essence. Imagine nothing exists in the world. You can imagine. Or just focus on essence of God, even if other things exist. You know, just focus on God. God has knowledge. You may say, but knowledge needs something to be known. Like Razer needs something to be given. Say, yes, God knows himself. God knows himself. Even I go further, God knows us. But knowing us doesn't need us to be there. Is different from rizq. To give us rizq, we have to be there. But to know us, we don't need to be there. He knew all of us before creating us. In his essence, he has knowledge of us. Okay? So, knowledge is a quality of essence. Power. To have power, you don't need to have something created. Before creating and after creating is the same for power. Power is there. Actually, when they, inshallah, if we get chance, we define power. Power is, in the technical, you know, language, they say, كون الفاعل بحيث إذا شاء فعل وإذا لم يشاء لم يفعل. Power means the ability of the agent, of the doer, to do if he wants to do, if he wills to do. So he may do, he may not do. It's not important whether he does it or not. The main thing is that he can do. Whether God creates or doesn't create, he has power. Yeah? So for power, you don't need to have something that is already created. So power is a quality of essence. Even when there was nothing, God still had the power. And now he has power. His power is not increased or reduced by creation. Is it clear? So these are qualities of essence. Qualities of essence are eternal. This is not very accurate. I say when, but I have no other choice. Whenever God existed, I cannot say when accurately, but I don't have any language other than this. So in any way that you can think of God's existence, those qualities of essence are also with God. But qualities of action can be coming in a certain time. For example, before God created human beings and jinns, there was no kafiriyya. Forgiveness was not there. Why? Because there was no sinful person. Yeah. So, qualities of action can come in time. But qualities of essence do not come in certain time or space. They are always with God. They are not separable from God. They are eternal. I think I stop here. I hope we made the basis, and inshallah, we would build on this, inshallah, in the next session. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.